Like, I think you're amazing. And because I was watching 227 the other day, right? And I was like, there you go. It's like, y'all don't understand. Like, it's the longevity, and also, like, you know, the like, you have made it so, like, you can be a class act and still get through this industry. You know
I'm
what I'm
telling you.
saying?
Let me do, thank you, sweetheart. I appreciate that. Do you remember my famous line in that 227? When I said, if I had known you was blood, we could have stayed in the old neighborhood.
Was this, like, Mary, like, between Mary and you, like, it was okay.
My friend Jack A, that's my buddy. That's where we first met. She, as a matter of fact, she met her husband, Eldrin. She met at my house at my Halloween party. I used to have one of the biggest Halloween parties there was. That's where she met Eldrin. Same night, CCH Pounder and Jennifer Lewis, everybody was at my house because I'd have a huge Valentine's party
I
every
should have went. I should have. Man, listen. I would have been too excited because it was just, because listen, y'all are amazing. Like, that whole genre of, like, people don't understand, like, that whole, those years were great TV, great host,
Thank
not
you.
just, you know, it was something to make you think, something to make you change the way that you react. Like, even when in when Family Matters, when the dude was talking to the new manager or whatever, the store was talking to you, and I was like,
And you
that
told me
helped.
I wasn't qualified for that job.
And you ran it down like it was nothing.
I got the Alice Award for that. You know what the Alice Award is?
No,
The
you
Alice
really
Award, was an award that you would have to go to Washington, D.C. to get it from the National Council of Working Women. And it was given to the most honest portrayal of a working woman on TV. And I beat out 250 women that year. And I had to go and get it from Candace Bergen. Then I had to go back and pass it on to Katie Couric. So I was stepping in high cotton, okay?
Oh my gosh, because you read, listen, I went because I we used to work in corporate. I'm a full-time entrepreneur now, but when you read that down, I was like, because I have three children. You went through a divorce, all of that, and someone told me that. I was like, wait a minute. They told me I wasn't qualified. I said, wait a minute now. I had to channel that and run it down.
Hold up now. And we got it from our queens, our mothers and our grandmothers, you know, and also we know how to handle stuff. You know, we have to.
Yes,
We have
and
to, you know.
I was like, yo, like y'all, and then I still watch. Okay, I rewatch shows because I don't like any of the new stuff. Like I actually rewatch a lot of shows over and over, and my kids always ask me, "You not gonna watch nothing different, no?" You know, because it's I love this. I love it. Because I know we're waiting for Kelly
Kelly.
to get on, and I want to. I'm just gonna go ahead and get into it because I just,
Okay.
oh, because
Because my baby probably trying to get them little babies their dinner and her husband
I,
too.
right.
So let's go on. If she can
Yeah,
come
but
in, she'll
she lives
come
in
in.
this area. Like she, I live in Virginia. She lives in like Maryland, D.C.
My daughter went to school in Virginia. She went to VUU.
Oh my gosh, that's right down the street. Okay, you know what? Y'all just so close. So I want to ask about because you know Christmas movies are coming up, right? So I love the play on the name of Family Matters Christmas. So my question is this: with Peggy writing the story, did she take any of the elements from your previous works? Was did
No,
that come into play?
I don't think so. You know what? They really asked me and Reggie both, because Reggie was supposed to read the story. He's supposed to be the story reader, but he was hooked up on a project and all, because it
Oh.
was going to be done totally different and all. But Carl, Reggie, to play Carl, he was
Yes.
Mel Johnson. He was going to be the we were going to be married, but he was going to be the storyteller, the grandpa,
Oh.
and all. And then he couldn't do it. And then so they said, "Well, you're always telling stories when you're sugar mama. Will you be the storyteller?" So I said, "Yeah, I'll come in and do it." So, you know, I flew in there to do it. I knew this. I knew what the story was, and it's such a beautiful story. I don't know if you've seen the actual movie yet, and it's incredible. It's a beautiful story. So the play on Family Matters, initially it did have another name, and but you know something? When we thought about it, and people say, "Well, is it a people start asking, is it a Family Matters Christmas?" Me and Kelly was in it. Is it a family? I said, everybody has a Family Matters Christmas. Nobody owns Family Matters. Ask Greg, Judge Greg Mathis. Anybody can use Family Matters. I know people associated with that and all, But we did not, we never published that. We were using the entire cast. We titled it A Family Matters Christmas. And all of the press that we put out there, we said uniting myself and Kelly. We did not say any of the other cast members or whatever. Okay. And it didn't happen that way. You know, I mean, if we could have gotten some of the others, we may have, but that's not what we intended to do. The story that Peggy wrote was a totally different story. And I was telling the story, so I became the storyteller.
Uh-huh. And I'm going to say this. I do love your sugar mama on the Proud Family.
Come on, man. Come on, sugar.
I was saying this. Like, sugar mama kept it 100. Just said what she wanted to say. I just had to throw that in real quick.
You wait till next season when you see her cutting up like a fool.
in the first, okay, I know we supposed to be talking about the movie, but the first time you talking to Poppy or whatever, I love
Okay. That's okay. Let's have fun.
Yes. Okay. So that's what I want to ask about the play, because a lot of people, you know, go back to the interview, when a lot of people see the family, I was like, wait a minute, just dispel that. Let's clear that up a little bit.
Right.
But the storyline was a blended family, right?
Right.
My thing is this, there's a lot of that happening now.
Yes.
And so I think this movie is a great way to try to give, you know, families something to look at, to have a good example, because some of these blended families, they're introducing people that don't even know each other.
Right. But you know, Sister Chandra, although, you know, we have gotten some yays and some nays as the name in the movie, Family Matters Christmas, renaming it A Family Matters Christmas. But when people see this movie and they see how beautiful this movie is, and also that anybody from the age to 6 to 96 can watch this movie, because that's what we do. And they can see how we still have that same beautiful element of bringing family together through love and understanding and respect and appreciation. You know what? I just say, watch the movie. Watch the movie. Yeah. You know, my mother used to say, don't worry about the messenger, pay attention to the message. You know, leave the small things aside.
Uh-huh. And that's what my thing was, because I watched the trailer, but for me, I want to watch the movie. Like, I want to sit down with my children and watch
it. Right.
You know, because a lot of people's pre-screen movie, I want to enjoy it fresh.
Right.
And, you know, with my kids and with my family, I do feel like, especially, you know, everybody start putting things up for Christmas around Halloween.
Right.
This is a great way to go into Thanksgiving and stuff.
Right.
But the way that you all are releasing it so that everyone can have access, they don't have, you know, that is a great option now, because people don't want to go, you know. Right.
I'm almost willing to bet you, nobody's going to walk out of that movie disappointed or angry. I can say that right now. I can honestly say that right now. They'll be happy that they saw that movie. And, you know, and if it hadn't been like that first, out the gate, it won 2 awards already. I know you know that. It won Best Film and Fan Favorite for that movie. And also, when people see that movie, as a matter of fact, I may even sponsor a family night myself with the movie. I'm thinking about it. By the end of the week, I'll make a decision on it at one of our performing arts centers here, and just sponsor a night myself where I buy all the popcorn and the hot dog and everything, just so people in my neighborhood can sit down, and in my hood rather, can sit down and watch another beautiful family movie that I'm hoping they will treasure and want to look at every year, because it's a beautiful movie. It really is. I'm proud of it.
You got certain movies that you do watch every holiday. Mm-hmm. I have my list, and from the trailer, like, I can't wait to add that to my list, because I'll probably watch it over and over again. Okay, you know, I watch things over and over again. Mm-hmm. So the kids will probably come in. You watching it again? Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yes, I am.
Yes, that's right. it's like Drumline. I can watch Drumline the same way I watched The Wizard of Oz and The Ten Commandments and all that stuff. I can just watch it over and over and over again. It's just some movies you love. You just keep watching them, you know?
And it feels, and this is like a feel good to have, but to show that the child, he's a whiz. It's like, listen, y'all, I don't want to tell y'all about every character in the story, but I need y'all to watch the movie. But just like, there's so much representation.
Right.
You cannot miss that part.
Right.
Because, you know, we don't get portrayed some of the portrayals, we don't get to see that often. And when we do, it's like in short, short spans. Mm-hmm. But this movie.
Mm-hmm. Mm. And I know people want to see us all back together. You know, when I did a Hallmark with Reggie, We did the Flight Before Christmas with Maya. Man, I'm telling you, it blew up. I think we got more publicity. Reggie and I got more publicity than they did because they wanted to see us back together. But you know what, sweetheart? Sometimes it's not as easy as people think it is to go back and try to recoup and recover. Some people don't want to work together anymore. They finish with it. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And I think the most negative response I got to this movie, and I did answer it. I did. And I answered it from my heart. I didn't answer from my mouth or my mind. And I'll answer from my heart because that's where I speak from. And I saw one of the comments on there. Oh, is the little girl that was a prostitute going to be on it? And I answered it. I don't know if people are going to see this, but I don't care if they see it because I'm, like I said, I speak from my heart. And when I read that, I said, no, just N-O. And I put a smiley face with a big teardrop and a heart to say, I love you. No, I love you. And that's all I had to say. Because I thought it was mean-spirited and everything and all, but I have the kind of forgiving heart and all. And I know a lot of people say things they probably don't really mean, you know? And I just have to let it roll off my back because I ain't trying to get a bunch of wrinkles and stuff in my face.
That black don't crack. That's it.
Michael Dyson was doing a program one night and I walked in and said, she is, that a queen. Then he said, listen, I want all of y'all to look around so y'all can notice that black don't crack. He said, but with this one, good black won't even wrinkle.
Hello. That's where I'm trying to get. That's what I'm like, I ain't worried about nothing. But I love the fact that you didn't engage and you did leave it where it was because, you know, I'm working on that because, you know, I'm saved adjacent. So I still forget that to set it down and I say stuff. So I'm working on that.
Because we're still family. No matter what, you know, we're still family. Right. And I know that this is about our Christmas food and everything and all, but I got to mention it because, like I say, I speak from my heart and everything. It's even without two, you know, our two that the whole our industry just tried to make it, just blow it up into something bigger than what it was with Will and Chris. I love Will Smith and I love Chris Rock too. And I wish they would just leave it alone because we as family, we're going to be family no matter what. You know, right. Leave it alone.
I mean, our culture is different. We could all, you fight at the family reunion, be sitting at the table laughing on Thanksgiving. Like,
that's right. We're going to love up on each other no matter what. You know, we still going to love each other. I'm going to still love them no matter what.
And that's what I keep trying to tell people. Like, y'all say, y'all don't understand. That happened. Right. Y'all blew it up a portion. They was going to be having drinks next week if y'all hadn't said nothing. But
that's right. And then on top of that, we done seen worse than that. And folks come back and be hugging up and loving on each other. You know, so leave it alone.
Yes. So this is what I really, between this movie and I've seen, you've done, your body of work is so amazing. Lord have mercy. I can go down the list like, no, I don't want to talk about that one. I do. Like, it's kind of hard to pick because your voice is distinctive. You know, I know your voice. And I can hear someone like that. I know who that is. Like, I know your voice. And it's like, that it's, you are such, the role that you had with, you know, Miss Harriet, you know, you put, the reason why your voice is distinctive is because to me, the love and the care that you gave to your family, be it a TV or not, you heard it. So that's what I get when I hear your voice. I hear like a mom and, you know, a caring, nurturing person. And I know that may sound crazy, but no matter what role it is, that's what I hear. And it's so soothing. I can listen to it and it makes you, and you can just do that.
Thank you. Yeah, I appreciate that.
You gave the, you know, there's, you know, Mary Jenkins, she was a mom, you know, she was that mom too, but you showed there was a loving couple, a loving black couple, with no fight, no craziness, you know,
no disrespect ever. We never disrespected each other ever.
And I'm like, if people go back and watch the show, and I know it may be fictional, but it's a great way to you see how a couple can respect each other, be honest with each other, be transparent. And that's a good representation of, I'm sorry, I got to say for black people, we need to go back to that because the stuff that's going on now, I'm like, did y'all not see Carla, Harry, and how they acted, Mary and Lester? Like, there's couples that don't run each other with cards. You know, we don't have to do that.
Well, you know something? Divorce was not an option for us. We were that kind of couple that divorce was not an option. We were going to stay together no matter what. Wish I could have done it in real life, but, you know, we it was not an option, you know. And I wish it would go back too. You know, a lot of young people I tell right now, I say, now everybody knows how many times I changed my name. But when I tell you, the young people, and I say, listen, if I had known then like I know now, they always say the grass is greener. That darn grass ain't greener. They just watered it a little bit more. You need to stay where you are.
Like the AstroTurf. You don't know.
That's it. That's it.
That's what's missing now. And I love that your honesty. I love that because it's like, that's something that's really missing from what we are doing now, you know? And it's a lot of stuff. It's like, even though it says social media is not realness, but people are imbibing and they're taking that in and emulating that in real life. And I'm like, no, that's not how that works. Couples can, you know, people can
work it out.
Yeah, and be themselves. I mean, it's like, you don't have to have all the dramatics to be impactful.
And you don't have to have a lot of money either. People think I have a lot of money. You don't have to have a lot of money. You know, money is the root of all evil. I believe it. Well, the lust for money is the root of all evil. I really believe that. And I think it breaks up a lot of marriages and relationships, you know. Ooh. And then it also creates another kind of poison. If there wasn't an inroad to come back, then it pulls it apart again, you know, out of greed, you know, and envy and greed.
I don't understand it. And that's like one of the things I tell people all the time. I say, you look at, you know, I'm like, we grew up different. So we had different visuals. Like I'm an 80s baby. So I grew up different seeing like the thoughtfulness and all of that. And I'm like, those are great examples. It's a beautiful thing to see to see that kind of a relationship. And then you kind of, like, I really want people to understand, you kind of set the benchmark, these sitcoms set the benchmark for people to go back and look at. And that's why I'm like, I'm so glad it's available, you know, at your fingertips to watch, because sometimes it inspire you to do something else, like to go about a situation. Because remember when that lady cop or whatever was doing a stakeout and did it in a wholesome way. You did it in a more rational way.
Right, right.
Like, I went to go check.
I went to go check on my man and everything and all, you know, let him know I still love him and show him what he had was better than what he was thinking about. Maybe he might want to get, you know, and this, that, and the other. And also, I was fighting for not only my husband, I was fighting for my family, you know, and everything. And I felt threatened. My family felt threatened. I felt the threat. And all, and whatever I needed to do in order to bring it back together, that's what I wanted to do, you know, and he proved it, you know, Carl proved it, that, you know, the love and respect that we had between each other was bigger than anything else, you know. And like I said, getting back to this Christmas movie with these kids, I don't want to kill it either, you know, or spoil it. And this Christmas movie really is a good Christmas movie. And you'll see some of that stuff in there from the other parents, from the other actors that are actually the parents of these kids.
So my question, because it's, you know, it's back to the movie, the blending, like, okay, so many families are blended now, right? Mm-hmm. And it's one of those things, like, to have a matriarch, you know, to have some kind of support, like, great support is very important. And that's the biggest thing I want people to, y'all gotta watch it, you know, watch the trailer, and I'm just saying, watch it, because you'll see a lot. And I know anything that you work with from the trailer alone, it's like, okay.
Yeah. And it is difficult when you got blended kids, and it doesn't matter what the special occasion is, or the occasion, whether it's special or not, you know, it's important that kids are accepting of that other person that's willing to step or wants to step into their life, not to take the other parent's place, but also to share the space of maybe helping to raise them to be a better person, to be a more productive person, to be a more loving person. And I think when you get to a certain point in your life, you know, where you do have children, whether you decide to remarry or your spouse remarries or whatever, and you have this blended family, it is important for them kids, for those kids to communicate.
Yes.
You know, and they don't have to, you know, just bow down because it is different. I have some stepbrothers and sisters. I didn't grow up with them, but they're still my stepbrother. My father is no more my father than he is their father. You see what I'm saying? Right. And I was open to them. We have a relationship, not the kind that I have with my natural brothers and sisters, because we were there with my mom. And right. But I do have a relationship. But on the other hand, my daughter, who's an only child, and her stepmother was vicious. Vicious. My granddaughter couldn't even go to the stepmother's house. She had to meet her dad on his job with her baby. Was vicious. And then when he died, I was on Facebook, I had people trying to find out what funeral home he's in. She didn't even go to her father's funeral. And that is devastating. It's devastating. It happens. But you know what? I try to raise my child in a way to get past certain things. And that right. some people are an example of how to or how not to be. And don't let that be a downfall for her to take her out of her good spirit of life and kindness to people. Get past that. And then too, we're in a shell, this shell that we're in. When I raised her and taught her how to pray when she was 4 years old and bought her a prayer word rug and wrote it down on a piece of paper because she couldn't remember the Lord's Prayer and stuff. Yeah. But I told her, like my mom told me, the first thing you do is you thank God for everything you got before you ask him for what you want. You said, thank you, Lord. And then you start praying. Yep. Because I told her, if I'm gone, okay, and I am going to leave here, we all going to leave here, you're going to need something to lean on.
Yep.
You better know how to pray. You better know how to find you a corner somewhere. Somebody that's going to listen to you unconditionally, let you cry, and still hold you up to get you through and all. That's how I try to raise her. And that's why right now she's good. Her dad's been gone now about 7-8 years. She's good. She's raising her daughter. And I'm hoping that she isn't holding any hatred or any regret in her heart, even for that other person, because anybody that's that mean, spirited, and you won't pray for them. Don't hold it against them. Pray for her. Don't give anybody power over you. When you hate people and you want terrible things to happen to people, you give them power.
Very true.
Hold on to your own power and know who's in charge of it.
And I love the fact that you said that, because a lot of the blended families, there's a lot of animosity sometimes.
That is.
And it's really no reason to have that animosity when, you know, there it's a blended situation. You're actually, you know, you're building on the family instead of, you know, taking away.
Right,
so
right.
I love the fact that you said that, you mm-hmm. know, because a lot of people have had those experiences with step parents and stuff like
right.
that.
That's right.
And there was no need for that. So,
and the kids are innocent. The kids are innocent. And you were in a loving relationship when you made those children and all. And you should still love and care about them, you know, whether they're yours or not, you know.
I keep trying to, and that's one of the things that I like, because with me being divorced, that mm-hmm. was one of the things I wanted to stress. I was like, hey, you know, we got to keep a line of communication. So the line that's of communication
right.
is
cut. That's right.
So, it, you know, he went there. He did. He wasn't there. So mm-hmm. that is exactly where I think a lot of people are missing the point. Like, the children were made out of the love. So mm-hmm. there's no reason to have this animosity, this anger between each other or between right. the new person that's come along, you know?
Right.
But, you know, I think.
And the greatest gift that we can give each other mm-hmm. is love. The greatest yeah. gift that we can give each other is love, really, you know? And because yeah. that's what Christmas really is about, you know? We got a gift. When we got somebody that could come in and, you know what? I believe everything in the Bible, even if I don't practice it. And I'm not perfect, not by a long shot, but I believe everything in that Bible, you know. And I believe that Christmas is about the gift of life and love and everlasting life, if you believe, you know, if you have strong faith. And and that's what carries me a lot of times. That's why I don't worry about a lot of things. I won't say that I don't worry about anything, because I'm human and all. But I don't let anything just, it may take me down, but it ain't going to take me out. It's got to be a lot to take me out, you know.
And so this is what I will say, and I want people to understand about Christmas movie, like every, you know, the Silent Night from the the Temptations, I think it's
Temptations. Yes, uh-huh.
That is how we know Christmas is coming.
That's right. That's right. That and Donna Hathaway.
There you go.
Hang all the mistletoe. The minute you hear that, boy, it's on.
It could be October 31st. Right. We started right. Christmas.
That's right. But you know something? In my neighborhood, everybody knows when Christmas starts in my neighborhood. It starts on November 2nd. And it's been like that for 15 years. And the reason that it's like that is because that's my mother's birthday. And my mother passed 15 years ago, be November 2nd. And to honor her, my baby brother at our home, which is about 10 minutes from where I am with my daughter's house here, our home, he puts the lights up and he lets them stay up all year long, but he doesn't turn them on. He lets them stay there because he don't want to keep climbing back and forth on the house. And all he does is just plug them in. And when he plugs those lights in on November 2nd, everybody says, oh, Miss Payton is here, it's on. Because he's opened up the entire neighborhood. People come by and it's really beautiful. It looks like a piece of jewelry is what it looks like. And that's how we know. They said, we know it's Christmas when Vail Payton plugs those lights in to say hello, mama. That's when Christmas starts. Starts with my mother's birthday. In my neighborhood, yeah.
And this movie, it comes out on November 8th, y'all. So keep in mind now, listen, these dates are very important to remember, okay? Yes. And what neighborhood is so I can swing by? Never mind, don't say it on record. I'll do this off.
It's in Miami because I'm actually from Miami, so I'm back home. And I actually came back home because my mother had a triple bypass. And my schedule was more flexible than my brothers and sisters. I had 6 brothers and 2 sisters. The only brother that's gone is the one that was a Marine. He's the only one that's passed. And so I came home to take care of my mother and met her respiratory therapist, gorgeous man, fell in love with him. And he said, I'll move back to LA. He told me how long he had been on his job. I said, tell you what, you stay here. 20 some odd years, you stay here, I'll move back. So I moved back to Miami and I just float back and forth wherever I need to go.
We'll talk offline.
We'll talk offline. I'm here. I'm back home. I'm back home with my folks.
Okay, just what I need.
Tommy.
I need some help in that area because that's,
let me tell you, Chandra, you have made my day because I was feeling a little bit down, because of all this construction, but I took my other COVID test yesterday, that new one they got, and took all of them. COVID, whooping cough, you name it. Whatever they say out there, I need to take, I take. And I took my flu shot and I took both of them and I was feeling kind of a little feverish and everything and all. And I said, well, you know what? You got to do what you got to do. You know, it's called show business. You better show up.
Yeah.
But you know, sometimes you may not feel like doing something, but you go into a good spirit or you go into that good energy and then it just makes everything. And that's what you did. So thank you.
Because I was excited. Like I told you, I went to my workout. I've been working out trying to get back and, you know, get myself back.
Right.
I was like, listen, I got to go. I got something very important to do. I was like, I'm so late. That is so disrespectful. I was like, no, I got to get But like I told you, I admire you so much. And you have, okay, I'm sorry. Like,
That's all right. On the honor side of things, you had a question here. I'm looking at the questions. I have them right above me. But you did have a question here. And the question was, how does a Family Matters Christmas movie get done without Steve Urkel? And I don't want to not answer it for you, to answer it for somebody else, and all, because I get asked about it. And I would just say that Family Matters, when it initially started 33 years ago, we started the show without him. And it was a success. And it was mainly a success because he was in it and all. Mm-hmm. But if we also remember, I left the show and it still carried on. We started the show without him. We ended the show without me. Nobody is irreplaceable. You know, there's always space for somebody and something to come in and to continue and this, that, and the other. And all. I wish him well. I loved him as a little boy. I really did. And I still care for him as a human being. But he was not asked to be in this movie the same way a lot of the others weren't asked because it wasn't that kind of movie. But it was a movie that had to do with family matters. And I felt that it was appropriate that we changed it and we named it that because that's what it is. And if people associated with it, then that's fine and good because we are there. I'm there. I'm not Harriet in the movie. And Kelly is not Lori in the movie, but we are there with another family. And that's what the movie is about, that other family.
And that's the dynamic. Like, it really, you, like you said, everybody has family matters. Everybody. There are, cause, and that's one of the things I will say, like my great grandmother used to say, you know, she said, that's family business, which that's is right. It's family that's matters. Right. Like, y'all got to understand. That's this right. is—it's more than just, and I don't know where the name for family marriage came from, but it was something.
It was there even before we got it, and all because I looked up, there were different family marriage in different countries and everything, and I got a lot of phone calls who just said, when Greg, and I know Greg Mathis, and when Greg did Mathis Family Matters, he was like, "How do you use family? We don't own Family Matters.
No,
we don't. nobody owns it." My wonderful producers, Tom Mill and Bob Boy, God bless them and everything and all, they created a beautiful show that you guys mm-hmm. still love. And all it was titled Family Matters, and that's what it was about. And but you know something? We all have family matters, whether it's good or bad. A lot of us celebrate Christmas, and it's a Family Matters Christmas. That's what it is.
It you know? Is.
And- like other people's.
And I'm going to tell y'all this, and this is something that, okay, y'all got to know y'all TV history, okay? With Perfect Strangers, right? When you was the elevator operator at Perfect, okay, so y'all got to know y'all TV history, okay? Stop. Y'all got to know y'all TV history, but, and then mm-hmm. he came back and played the new manager, okay?
right.
Yes, y'all got to watch it, and y'all got to do y'all history, because right. she's been booked and busy for, yeah.
Almost 50 years.
Yes,
since I was 24, I turned 72 this year, so I've been a professional actor since I was 24 years old. So I've been at it for a while. Yeah.
See, but the thing is, the reason why she don't look it, because she mind her business.
That's it. I mind my business. I do.
And I will keep giving you flowers because I love you. I don't know you personally, but I feel like I have, you know, grown up with you.
You know yes. me personally because you know my heart and my spirit. Yes, you do.
Yes. Okay. There we go.
And when you see me, like I tell people, when you see me, you know me. Even if you don't know me physically, you know me. So I don't have a problem with people hugging me. I didn't have a problem with people hugging me when COVID was here, but my husband did. He said, "You don't get COVID." I said, "I tell you what, but that ain't what I'm going to die from. I tell you that. They ain't going to be that. It might be something else." You know what I'm saying? Jesus lived among the lepers.
Yes, he did. He walked among
See, yeah, he did. Yeah, he did.
And he flipped tables. So when I do it, I'm being like Jesus.
That's right. The same way somebody said to me, was talking to me about church. I said, "Let me tell you something. Out of all the years, I've read the Bible like 3-4 times and still sometimes say, I don't remember reading that, you know, at all, but I've read it from front to back and you always learn something different about it. And not that I'm super religious or anything, but I do believe in God and I pray every day. And but somebody asked me, say, "But do you go to church?" I said, "I don't go to church every Sunday. I don't need to go." I said, "I have looked in so many Bibles and I got a bunch of them, even a Gullah Bible." I said, "I don't remember, but one time I saw Jesus in a church and he was throwing stuff out when he went in there because they were selling stuff. He was throwing stuff out. He was out in the street amongst people. So all of them glorified, sitting up there in the church, folks, and all. Jesus was out there with the lepers, with the blind people, with the prostitute, with the Mary Magdalene and all that stuff. That's where Jesus was and everything. And he lives in your heart and your soul and spirit. But COVID showed us a lot of things. There are pluses and minuses to everything. COVID showed us that God ain't going to strike you down dead just because you don't walk through that door. Come on now.
Exactly. See, listen, people get on me because, I said, I'm saved adjacent. Mm-hmm. And I keep trying to tell people, y'all make it so big about how to, God is right here all the time.
Yes, I don't
have to go through and tithe all my money and sit up in church for 4 hours. I'm not knocking anybody that do, my faith is not based on a building or idolizing a pastor. That's cool and everything. They gonna die one day too. I just want to make sure that God get my message because I don't know what the pastor, I don't know his mind is clear.
Listen. I'm going to tell you, I say, I do not need to be up there with 3-4 hours with you trying to pray for stuff you did. It'll take me a minute to ask God to forgive me what I did. You want me to stay up there all day with you because you done did all this dirt that you did. And then also, the people that go there because they have these pity parties, that's not what it's for. When you do go there, you're supposed to be amongst people, first of all, to be thankful and to pray for people and to help people that might be struggling as far as having something to believe in that's more than themselves. And I have a young man that he's so depressed, and I'm not going to call his name. He knows who he is if he sees this. So depressed because he didn't ever know who his father was, you know. And this time I said, your father is up in heaven. And I said, let me tell you something. Moses didn't know who he didn't find out. He was an orphan. Moses was an orphan, okay, raised by somebody else. Studied because his brother Aaron had to talk for him. Stop having pity parties and things and all. Appreciate where you are. Appreciate your portion. You don't need to be rich. Let me tell you something my mama say. Don't even worry about where you live. Pray for good neighbors.
That's it.
Because I got a whole bunch of friends in Beverly Hills. They fight like hell. And I got a whole bunch of friends in the ghetto, in the hood, and they're happy as hood rats. You know what I'm saying? See, don't worry about where you live. Pray for good neighbors.
That's it.
That's what you do.
A good neighbor save you faster than, you know what I'm saying, than having all of these, like, and that's, you know what? See, this is a lesson, y'all, in this interview. Y'all going to learn a lot.
And a good friend, too. And a good friend. You better have a friend like Jesus with Lazarus, because Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. You better hope you got a friend like that.
We all need a friend like that.
Right. This has been wonderful. You gave me a chance to vent. I think you froze up.
I think I...